I made a lot of claims in the last hour about what kind of things exist and what their properties are. And in this half, we're going to just walk through a toy model. At least most of the hour is going to be spent walking through a toy model and seeing how some of these properties can come about. The model in particular, probably a lot of people have seen it already. It's known as the toric code. It was introduced in this context by Alexei Kateyev again. In fact, this model was around a long time ago in the 1970s. A lot of high energy theorists had studied it in a lot of different ways. But Kateyev, in his usual brilliance, he realized how important it was to make the relationship between this model and error correcting codes. So the thing that's interesting about this toric code is that you can think of it either as an error correcting code, or you can think of it as a real phase of matter, stuff that could exist in some physical system. And that sort of duality is something that's sort of typical and very important in this field. So without further ado, here's the model. We're going to start with a square lattice, and I'm going to put a spin 1/2, or a qubit, on every edge of the square lattice. Easy enough, so the dimension of the Hilbert space is 2 to the number of spins we have in the problem. The only thing I'm doing that's a little bit unusual is I'm going to take this square lattice, I'm going to wrap it up into a donut. Okay? So it's periodic boundary conditions in both directions. You go off the top, you come in the bottom. You go off the right, you come back in the left, like the game Asteroids. You ever played Asteroids? You know this? Okay. People of my generation have. So. Okay. So now I'm going to, if I want to describe one of the basis states in this Hilbert space, I can do so by just specifying which of the spins are spin up and which ones are spin down, or which ones are 0 and which ones are 1. Here I've painted all the down spins red. Now, just for my own nefarious purposes, I'm going to come up with a different representation of these spins being up or down. I'm going to paint the bond red if the spin is down, or in the 1 state, and I'm going to leave it unpainted if it's in the up state. So you can see that these are really the same pictures. Here you have 3 spin downs across the top, 3 across the top, then there's 3 down here, 3 down here, there's 4 coming to an intersection here, here. So it's exactly the same picture. Is everyone happy with that? I hope. Okay. And you'll notice actually that this bond goes off the top and comes back in the bottom, so you can see the little piece of red coming back in the bottom because it went around the handle of the torus. Okay? All right. So that's our Hilbert space. And the next thing I have to do is I have to define some operators in this space. The first operator I'm going to define is going to be known as a vertex operator, and I can define it at each vertex. And it's simply the product of sigma z for all the 4 bonds coming into the vertex. I guess if you're from the quantum computing field, you might call it just z operators. Do people use that, or do they like sigma z better? Like z, sigma z? Z better? Sorry. I live in England. I still haven't gotten this right. I'm so sorry. So sigma z operators here. And the properties of this operator is that if there's an even number of down spins coming into a vertex, then it takes the eigenvalue plus 1. And if there's an odd number of down spins coming into that vertex, then it has an eigenvalue of minus 1. So in this particular state of the system, if I apply the vertex operator here, there's an even number of red bonds coming in, so it's a plus 1 eigenstate. Whereas if I apply the vertex operator here, it's a minus 1 eigenstate because there's 1 red bond coming in. Everyone still happy? Yell if you're not. Okay, good. So this is a fairly easy operator to define. And then here's another operator, which is a little bit less easy to define, but it's not that bad. It's now you take a plaquette with 4 spins going around a plaquette, and you multiply by sigma x for all these 4 spins. So it's product of 4 sigma x's around the plaquette. And that has the effect of flipping over all the bonds, all of the spins along those 4 bonds around the plaquette. Okay? So for example, if I apply the plaquette operator here, it will turn the red things unred, and the unred things will become red like that, just like magic. And then here, I apply a plaquette operator here, it will take the 3 red ones and turn them unred, and the unred one will become red. Everyone still happy with that? Okay. Just a couple of cautions. If you read papers on toric code, there is a great divide between conventions. That some people define the toric code where the vertex operators are sigma x's and the plaquette operators are sigma z's. And some people, the way I have done it, have defined the vertex operators to be sigma z's and the plaquette operator to be sigma x's. I'm sticking with this convention. Bear with me if you learned it a different way. Okay. Another comment is that both of these operators squared will give you one. That should be obvious here because sigma z squared is one and sigma x squared is also one. You apply twice, you get back to where you started. Okay. All right. Now, what may not be so obvious is that these operators all commute with each other. I suppose it's obvious that the vertex operators all commute with the vertex operators because sigma z commutes with sigma z, and the plaquette operators commute with plaquette operators because sigma x commutes with sigma x. What's not obvious is that sigma x, the vertex operators commute with the plaquette operators. And the reason for this is because if a plaquette operator and a vertex operator share an edge, they have to share two edges, like this. So here are this vertex and this plaquette share two edges. So instead of just having one operator, so sigma x and sigma z anticommute, but since they share two edges, then you have two things that anticommute with each other, so the vertex operator and the plaquette operator actually commute with each other. But an easier way to see this is just to ask, well, what happens? So this vertex operator here, it's in the minus one eigenstate because it has one red bond coming in. And then if I hit this plaquette here with a plaquette operator, it flips over all those bonds, and still that vertex operator is in the minus one eigenstate. Instead of having one red bond, it now has three red bonds because two of them got flipped over. That's still an odd number, so it's still minus one. Similarly, you can do it down here. Here it's in a plus one eigenstate because there's two red bonds coming in. I can flip over a plaquette. It still leaves the parity of the number of red bonds coming to the vertex the same, so that means the plaquette and the vertex operators commute. Everyone happy still? Good. All right. So we have here a whole mess of commuting operators, and the question we want to ask is this a complete set? In other words, if I specify the eigenstates of all of these operators, have I completely specified the state of the system? Well, it kind of looks like I might have, because the number of spins in the system is equal to the number of vertices plus the number of plaquettes. To convince yourself of that, the unit cell in this picture has two edges, one vertex, and one plaquette. So you have exactly the same number of spins as you have vertices plus plaquettes. So it looks like you have just enough operators to define all the state of the system completely if you specify the eigenstates of all the vertex and plaquette operators. But it turns out that's not quite true. And the reason it's not quite true is because all the V's and all the P's are not entirely independent. In fact, there's two constraints that are left on the system. And those two constraints are the product of all the plaquettes have to multiply to 1, and the product of all the vertices have to multiply to 1 also. To explain why this is, let's imagine two vertex operators right next to each other. On this intervening bond here, you've been hit by sigma z twice. If you hit something with sigma z twice, that's just the identity. So if you multiply by all of the vertex operators everywhere in the entire system, you've hit each edge twice with sigma z. Hitting each edge twice with sigma z is the same as hitting each edge with the identity. So the product of each vertex, product of all the vertex operators has to give you one. Similarly, with the plaquette operators, if you hit two neighboring plaquettes with the plaquette operators, it means you hit the intervening bond with sigma x twice. Sigma x squared is the identity. So if you hit all the plaquette operators if you hit all the plaquettes with the plaquette operators, you've then just done the identity operation on everything. Good? So we actually expect that if I fix all the p's and v's in the entire system, there will be 2 degrees of freedom that I've left unspecified. And I wasn't here for Daniel Gottesman's talk. I believe he talked about stabilizer codes. These are going to be the stabilizers for our codes, mutually commuting operators. We're going to fix the eigenstates of these plaquette and vertex operators, and there's still going to be a logical qubit, two logical qubits, left over for us to play with. Okay? So let's construct our code. So our first code is to specify that all the vertex operators are in the plus one eigenstate. So what does that mean? Well, putting all the vertex operators in the plus one eigenstate is saying that that the red bonds have to always be an even number coming into each vertex. So this configuration would be allowed by this rule, because each edge has, in this picture, has either two or zero red bonds coming into it. So all the edges, all the vertices are in the plus one eigenstate. This would, so, and then we can see that what we're really specifying is all the configurations in this picture are loops. And that's why I've drawn these things as red bonds. So you can trace that these things are actually forming loops. This would also be an allowed configuration. All the vertices have an even number of red bonds coming into each other. As with this, this is also a loop configuration. These two vertices have four red bonds coming into each other, and that's allowed also by the rule. Okay? So everyone happy with that? Good. Okay. The second rule is we have to specify that all the plaquettes are in the plus one eigenstate as well. What does this mean? Well, remember, so putting the plaquette in a plus one eigenstate is the same thing as saying that each plaquette should be in an equal superposition of being flipped and being unflipped. So for example, if we take a single plaquette and we look at the superposition of all of them down plus all of them up, that is a plus one eigenstate of the plaquette operator, because if you hit this thing with a plaquette operator, it becomes this. If you hit this thing with a plaquette operator, it becomes this. So this whole thing, this superposition, is invariant on the plaquette operator, meaning it has an eigenvalue of plus one. Everyone happy? Good. I keep asking you if you're happy. Maybe I should stop doing that. If you're not happy about something else, don't tell me. I don't know. Right. So this is also a perfectly good eigenstate of the plaquette operator with plus one, because this thing gets flipped over and turns into this. This thing gets flipped over and turns into this. As with this, this is gets flipped over and turns into this. This gets flipped over and turns into this. It has to be an equal superposition of flipped and unflipped plaquettes. So, in fact, the space that we specified by pinning down these eigenstates of the vertex and plaquette operators is that the wave functions we're talking about must be everything that we can, all loop configurations we can get to by flipping plaquettes over. So you can imagine starting with some particular configuration, loop configuration, say the empty configuration of no loops, and then flipping over all the plaquettes in every possible way. So flip this, superpose with this, superpose with this, and add them all up. And if we add them all up, we will get something that satisfies these two rules. Okay? Now, we expect that there are two logical qubits remaining. When we specified all the P's and V's, there should be 2 degrees of freedom remaining, and let's see if we can find where they are. The question we should ask is whether, when we flip over all of the plaquettes, whether that gets us to all the possible allowed loop configurations. And the answer is it does not. And the reason it doesn't is because flipping over plaquettes doesn't change the parity of the number of loops running around a handle. Let me show you what I mean by that. If you draw a green line all the way around the torus here, and I imagine flipping over plaquettes like this one, it doesn't change the parity, the evenness or oddness, of the number of red bonds that cut through that green line. So here it's 4, here it's 2. And no matter how many times I flip over plaquettes, it's always going to be even. So I never change that. Now, if I started instead with this picture, this is a perfectly good loop configuration, always even number of red bonds coming into each vertex, and I start flipping things over, it's always going to be an odd number of red bonds running around cutting through that green loop. Okay, so you never change from even to odd or odd to even. So in fact, the space we're... we can even do this. We can make the odd number go from 1 to 3, you know, by flipping over a whole bunch, but but the parity always stays the same. It's always even or it's always odd. Okay, here we go again. So the wave functions we're talking about are actually of this form, some arbitrary coefficient times a wave function which we call even-even, which is a superposition of all possible loop configurations which have an even number of loops running around both handles. Then another coefficient, arbitrary coefficient, times a wave function even-odd, which has an even number of strings running around one handle, an odd number going around the other, plus another coefficient times odd even, plus another coefficient times odd odd. Okay, so these are this is our code space. These four coefficients, which represents two qubits. If you want to be a little picturesque about it, you can draw the torus. This is the even wave function. It's a superposition of no loops plus some loops plus loops that run around an even number of times around both handles. This would be the even odd. It has an even number of loops running around one handle and an odd number of loops running around the other handle, and as do these and these and so forth. This code space is going to end up being highly protected from any sort of errors, and we'll work through the errors in a few moments. Okay? All right. Now, it's just a sort of comment. The codes based on this, things called surface codes, which are basically the toric code with some minor bells and whistles added on, are basically the best, as far as I know, some other people may correct me, but as far as I know, they're the best codes as far as being robust against errors that we know of. That they're, you know, they have a threshold for errors which is in the percent range as compared to lots of the old codes that people, you know, error correcting codes which have thresholds for errors which are way down in the, you know, very small fraction of a percent range. So when people actually get around to building a quantum computer, you know, there's going to be some errors, and they're going to probably use these types of error correcting codes to keep their quantum information protected. So what does this have to do with condensed matter physics? Why would I ask that question? Well, I'm a condensed matter physicist, so why on earth am I interested in this at all? Well, the reason I'm interested in this is because there's another way to think about this code in terms of phases of matter. So we have these conditions. These are vertex operators, and we're specifying the eigenstate of these vertex operators and these Paquette operators. But I can come up with a phase of matter which has this property, and the way I do it is I imagine a Hamiltonian which is negative the sum of all the vertex operators and the sum of all the Paquette operators. These operators all have eigenvalues which are plus 1 or minus 1. The ground state of the system is therefore the space of states which satisfy this rule. That's the lowest energy I can possibly get for this Hamiltonian. And so this matter is basically picking out the code space. The ground state of this Hamiltonian picks out the code space. There's a degenerate code space. There's several possible ground state wave functions which are specified by the number of loops running around each handle. And here's the interesting thing. The different ground states cannot be distinguished from each other by any local measurement. The only way you can figure out which of these ground states you're in is you have to walk all the way around the handle of the torus and count the strings going all the way around the handle of the torus. If you only go halfway around the handle of the torus, you can't figure out the evenness or oddness of the parity of the number of strings going around. So the measurement that you have to make to figure out which of the ground states you're in is extremely non-local. This is what we call topological order. So this is sort of a detour and a nod to the entire field of condensed matter physics for the last 50 years. So ever since the age of Landau, one of the greatest physicists of the 1900s, we as condensed matter physicists have thought of phases of matter and phase transitions in terms of symmetries of the system we're thinking about and broken symmetries. So the classic example of this is a ferromagnet. When you're in a paramagnetic phase, there's no order parameter in the sense of any particular direction in space being picked out. But when you're in a ferromagnetic phase, there's a magnetization vector which points in one particular direction, and you've broken the isotropy of space and you've picked out a particular direction. And you can describe a whole lot of things about about the phase of matter and the phase transition between the paramagnetic and the ferromagnetic phase of matter just by knowing the symmetries of this local order that you've described. Topological order is outside of Landau's paradigm. There's no local order parameter from this. The order parameter has to do with looking around the entire handle of the torus and counting a parity in this particular case. Okay? All right. So there's a very close connection between this idea of topological phase of matter and the idea of a quantum error correcting code. So let's see if we can push this a little bit further. So now I'm going to talk about errors or excitation. So in the language of quantum computation or quantum information, we're going to talk about errors or, you know, defects, things that go wrong in our code. Whereas in the language of condensed matter physics, we're going to talk about excitations out of this ground state space. So here I'm not going to draw the spin-ups and spin-downs anymore in this picture. Just imagine we're in the ground state space. And I'm going to try to create an error by hitting the ground state with some operator. So, for example, let me apply a sigma x operator to this bond. What does that do? That flips over spins. This sigma x operator anti-commutes with the two vertex operators on either end, and therefore creates errors or defects, quasi-particle excitations, on these two vertices. Another way of saying that is that in the ground state, every vertex had to have an even number of red bonds coming into it. Now I flipped over this bond in the middle. Now this vertex and this vertex necessarily have an odd number of red bonds coming into them, and therefore they're in the wrong eigenstate. So we have an error. And we can keep going on and making more errors. So maybe if I flip over this bond here, like this, now I've flipped over this vertex operator again, so he's back in the ground state, but now this one's in an error. And I can keep doing that. I can keep moving these apart from each other by making more and more errors in my space. Okay. Now, there's another way to think about this, which I think is useful, is to remember that the wave functions we're talking about are superpositions over all flips of of the plaquettes. So let's imagine I start with a reference state with all the spins pointing up. In other words, with none of the bonds colored. That's my reference state, and I have to, in the back of my head, remember that what I'm actually doing is I'm starting with the reference state, then I'm going to flip over all the plaquettes that I can. Now, if I take this reference state, so here I'm flipping over the plaquettes. Okay, there I flipped over plaquettes. More plaquettes, okay. Now I go back to the reference state. Let me make an error on some of these bonds, flipping these over with my sigma x operators. So I hit sigma x on these three bonds. Now this guy here has an error because he has an odd number of red bonds coming into it. This one has an error because he has an odd number of red bonds in it as well. I made a whole string of problems in between. Now, if I'm actually trying to treat this as an error-correcting code, I would have some guy coming along who's going to try to check the eigenstate of the vertex operator to all the vertices. So he's going to keep going through and check and make sure they're all in the right plus one eigenstate. And if he finds an error here, he's going to say, there was a mistake. We have to somehow figure out how to correct this. And he's going to go through and he's going to find another mistake here. Does he know that I made the mistakes in this order, that this one, then this one, then this one? Does he even know that I made this string like this? Well, he can never figure that out. He only knows that this guy is in the wrong eigenstate and this guy is in the wrong eigenstate. And if you remember that the actual wave function we're talking about is a superposition of all the flips of plaquettes, all you really know is that there's a string that connects this error, this vertex here, with this error vertex here. And somewhere out there, there's a string that's going to connect the two, but we don't know where that string actually is. Okay, that's a very important point. That the string is fluctuating all over the place, but we don't know where it is. We only know where the endpoints of the string are. Okay? So now I want to correct this error. How do I do that? How do I correct the error? Well, the way I correct the error, so I'm going to make the error again. Here I made the error. How do I correct the error? Well, I have to take these two things, I have to bring them back together to get rid of them. How do I do that? Well, let me flip over. Not sure what that was there for. I could have made the error this way as well. I could have made the error either by creating, error like this, or I could have made exactly the same error by making errors like this. Because these strings are actually fluctuating all over the place. The only thing I know is the endpoints of these strings. So how do I correct the error? The way I correct the error is I try to bring them back together by flipping over some more bonds like this, and then I bring them back together and eventually annihilate them. Okay? And the only thing I've left behind is this blue loop. So what is this blue loop? This blue loop is a product of sigma x's around some loop. And now the loop could have gone out here, but I know how I closed it up, but I didn't know how it was created because that was some error process that I didn't have control over. But I do know that I closed up the loop this way. And this closed blue loop is actually a product of all the plaquette operators enclosed. Remember, the plaquette operator is a bunch of sigma x operators, and if I hit the sigma x on this bond twice, it's the identity on this intervening bond. So the product of these sigma x's around this loop is the same as the product of plaquette operators on the enclosed plaquettes. And the plaquette operator is in the eigenvalue plus one in the ground state. So as long as I was in the ground state, once I close up this loop, I get back to the ground state with an overall phase of plus one. So I've corrected the error. Is that clear? Good? Happy? Okay. Now, how well is this code space protected? Well, if I start making some errors like this, make some more errors, keep moving this vertex around, and if I bring it all the way around the handle of the torus, now what I've done is I've created a set of spin flips all the way around the handle of the torus, and I've actually changed the ground state sector. I've changed the number of the parity of the number of strings running around a handle, and therefore I've now had a real error in my logical code space. And the way you combat this in practice is you just make sure the handle of your torus is really big. So it would take a whole lot of errors, the Hamming distance, if it were, if you like that word, the number of errors that you can sustain before you have a real logical error is just going to be very large. So you just want to have a big torus. Okay. Now, what about, so far I've been talking entirely about sigma x errors. I could also have sigma z errors. So what does a sigma z do? Well, let's hit this bond with a sigma z and see what happens there. Well, sigma z anti-commutes with the neighboring plaquettes, these guys here. So it's going to create two plaquette defects where the eigenvalue of this plaquette becomes minus 1 instead of plus 1, two errors on the plaquettes. Then you can keep making more plaquette errors, maybe by hitting this guy. Oops. Oh, let me explain what the plaquette errors are. So this was the plaquette. This superposition was a plaquette in the plus 1 eigenstate because it's a superposition of the plaquette and the flip plaquette. If you hit this thing with this blue operator, which is sigma z, hit it here with the blue operator is a sigma z, when the blue operator hits a downspin, it picks up a minus sign, so it goes to this, and this is now the plaquette in the minus 1 eigenstate. Because this thing gets turned into this thing gets turned into this under the plaquette operator, therefore I get minus the wave function I start with when I hit with the plaquette operator, so it's in the minus 1 eigenstate. So it's really, I'm just inserting a phase between the different string configurations by having a plaquette defect here. So I can make more plaquette defects by flipping over this, by hitting this with sigma z, and that will flip this over, and I can keep doing that to pull these plaquette defects apart from each other the same way I did with the vertex defects. Okay? And now how do I do error correction? It's exactly the same story. I don't know how this guy got from here to here, but I just pick some path to move them back together, annihilate them. And then the thing that I've left behind is this series of blue operators, the blue sigma z operators around this loop. I can think of this as living on a dual, on the dual lattice, these blue loops sort of cutting through my dual green loop here, these blue sigma z operators. It's a product of sigma z's around this loop here. But the product of sigma z's around this blue loop here is just the product of the vertex operators enclosed. So the vertex operator here, 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 and here. And then the vertex operator acts on this one, this one, this one, and this one twice. And therefore, it's trivial on these four in the middle, but non-trivial on these, eight that are sticking out there. And then the vertex operators acting on the ground state are necessarily in the plus one eigenstate. So when I've re-annihilated those plaquette defects, I'm now back down to the ground state with no errors. Okay, so that's how you do error correction. Good? Everyone happy? Good? Yes? Yell if you're not. Okay. In the same way we had with the vertex defects, we can move these plaquette defects all the way around a handle, like this, until they re-annihilate. And now what we have is we have the product of sigma z's all the way around a handle. So the product of sigma z's around the handle measures the parity of all the red bonds cutting through that green line. So for example, in this state, they would measure minus 1 because there's an odd number of red strings cutting across that green line. So since it's giving me a different result depending on the parity of the red lines cutting through this handle, it's giving me a different result for the different states in my code space, so it's giving a phase error on my code space. Okay, so this is if the defect walks all the way around the handle, it's making a genuine error on the logical qubit. Good? Yes? Yeah? Yell if you're not happy. I keep saying that, but okay. So now, being that I'm a topological guy, the first thing I want to do is I want to imagine what happens when I take one of these defects around another. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to make a plaquette defect. I'm going to pull it apart. I'm going to drag a vertex defect around the plaquette defect, re-annihilate it, and then re-annihilate the plaquette defect and see what happens. Okay? So let's do that. I have a little bit bigger torus, so I have room. So I'm going to make some sigma z's here, make some errors, make some plaquette defects, drag them apart from each other like this. Now I have two plaquette defects, which I moved apart from each other. Now I'll make some vertex defects, move them apart from each other, wrap them all the way around, bring them back together like this, and reannihilate. Okay, now this. Now let's look at this big blue loop, the dark blue loop that I made by dragging the vertex operator all the way around like this. This dark blue loop is a product of sigma x's all the way around this dark big blue square. That's the product of the Plaquette operators enclosed, and that is now minus 1 because one of the operators enclosed is in the wrong eigenstate. It's in the minus 1 eigenstate rather than the plus 1 eigenstate, so when I take this guy all the way around, it picks up a minus 1, and then I can reannihilate these guys and get a plus 1. Good? So the total phase I get for doing this process is overall minus 1. And it didn't matter how far apart these things were, it only mattered that they went around each other. So that's how you get topological phases. It's physics very, very similar to this. Good? All right. Yes? No? Maybe? All right. Okay. So now I'm back to this slide that I showed you in the last lecture, and I told you that in non-trivial topological theories, the ground state in the presence of quasi-particles and quasi-holes is degenerate. And in fact, we didn't have that in the toric code. So toric code is a trivial topological theory in some ways. We did have a ground state degeneracy when we put the topological theory on a torus. We got a multiple ground state degeneracy on the torus. There are other ways of getting ground state degeneracies by cutting holes in the system as well. That's what stable these surface codes are built on. But just by putting these quasi-particles and quasi-holes in the system, we didn't get any additional ground state degeneracy. We still left the ground state degeneracy exactly the same. It only depended on the number of loops around the, you know, evenness or oddness of the number of loops going around the handle. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to try to build up to a case which is a little less trivial, which is similar to the toric code, but in which you do have additional ground state degeneracy associated with multiple quasi-particles. Okay, so the toric code had many of the properties that I was describing of these topological theories, in the sense that, you know, there was a ground state degeneracy on the torus. When you braided particles around each other, you picked up some topological phase that only depended on how far apart the particles were from each other. They had some non-local order that you had to measure something very non-local in order to figure out what the qubit is and so forth. But it doesn't have this additional ground state degeneracy that we want. Okay, so let's see how we can build that up. And here I'm going to be a lot more vague because the real story is a little more complicated. But I'm going to try to work through it at least a little bit. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to be a little bit more abstract about how it is I describe the toric code. Remember that the toric code, we could describe its ground state space as just as a bunch of loop configurations, and all the configurations that I can get to by flipping over plaquettes as much as I can. Okay? And I never create vertex defects by flipping over plaquettes. If I start with no vertex defects, I never get vertex defects by making these plaquette flips. Now, what can I do by flipping over plaquettes? Well, one thing you can do by flipping over plaquettes is you can change the shape of a string. You can just topologically deform it from this, maybe hit these plaquettes, to this. Okay? This is typically, to a topologist, they call this isotopy, which means that a wiggly string is the same as a straight string. So this is going to be an important principle, that you can always straighten a string and you didn't change anything. Another thing you can do is in the toric code, you can remove a loop. If I take this loop here and I hit it with a bunch of plaquette operators, I can remove that loop. Okay? Flip them all over. And that, in this picture, some loop removal means the wave function with the presence of this loop should have the same coefficient as the part of the wave function without that loop, because it can be connected by flipping over plaquettes. Good? And the last thing that I can do is I can do what's known as surgery, which is flipping over two loops that come close to each other and connecting them up. You can sort of picture it like this. You have two strings that are kind of close to each other, and then you reconnect them. You can sort of see how that's surgery, sort of cutting and repasting. Okay, now, so another way of thinking of the toric code is to live in an abstract land here, and instead of thinking about the lattice, just thinking about all loops that can be obtained by these rules, straightening and wiggling strings, removing loops, and sugering them, okay? And if you make a superposition of all such loops, you have the ground state of the toric code. Good? Yes? Okay. Now we want to ask, what else can we do that would give us a different topological phase of matter with a lot of the same properties, but maybe some more interesting properties. Well, one thing we can do is we can add phases to these loop configurations. So this is a set of rules that we can come up with, which will add -1 to the number of loops times the loop configuration out front. So this means that every time I remove a loop, I should pick up a -1 sign, because the number of loops changes by 1. Every time I do surgery, I should also pick up a -1. And you know, it's because doing surgery will actually change the number of loops in the system by 1. Now, it actually, the only thing you have to do to make this modification on the toric code is change the plaquette operator such that it picks up a -1 every time a loop is removed or surgery occurs. It's a little tricky to get that right, to figure out when you get the -1 and when you don't, but it's a local operator, it's a local plaquette flip. It just, you just have to look at the neighbors and how many of the bonds are in the upstate and how many are in the downstate, and you can always sort of cook up a plaquette operator that will respect these rules. And then the ground state is still some sort of loop gas with all possible loops. It's that it's been superposed with different prefactors. Now this is known as the doubled semion model. And the reason for this is because it's very similar to the toric code. The only thing that's different is that the excitations have different braiding statistics. They still has the fourfold ground state degeneracy. The ground state degeneracy comes from the number of strings running around the handle. But the thing that's different is when you drag one particle around the other, you pick up a different phase, not a -1. So, and in fact, if you come from the condensed matter background, the physics of these excitations is that they're semions. They're halfway between fermions and bosons, and therefore they end up being called semions. I'm not going to prove that to you, but you know, it takes some work, and then it can be done. You have to trust me on that. But you can sort of believe that it has a lot of the same properties as the toric codes, but some minor differences. Okay, so how much can we generalize this story? We can generalize this story by allowing branches to the loops. So for example, this kind of configuration we might allow. We might allow these trivalent situations where two strings come in and one string comes out or something. But I'm still gonna require that the endpoints are going to be defects. This is something I'm always going to do. Endpoints are always defects. A string, if it comes to an end, it's going to be a defect. I might even add that there are multiple colors to these spins. Instead of just having a spin up and spin down, I might have spin 3/2 on an edge, or spin whatever on the edge. So I can think of those as being different colored strings. If it's in the up, it's red. If it's in the middle, it's blue. And if it's in the down, it's empty. The wave functions we're talking about will always be some sort of superposition between of all the possible configurations that I can have, which satisfy some sort of branching rules or loop rules, but with weights. And the weights can be phases, or they can have amplitudes. So we're going to require that in all these models that I can always straighten strings out. I can always remove loops at the price of some factor. So in the toric code, I removed a loop and I got exactly the same amplitude when I removed the loop. I didn't get any factor. In the doubled semion model, I got a -1 when I removed a loop. And more generally, you can pick up some arbitrary factor in more general models. And then my surgery rule could get more complicated. When I try to reconnect these two strings, they can reconnect like this, they can reconnect like this, and they can reconnect like this. And in general, you can get some superposition between them. And the final thing is that the endpoints, as I mentioned before, are going to always have to be defects. This will be some excitation. And these tadpoles will also be excitations. And you're going to have to trust me on that. The tadpoles always have to be excitations. I'm not going to justify that. Okay. So the simplest one, so now I'm going to work through a little bit the simplest one of these models, which has some of these more interesting properties. It only has one color edge, but it allows branching of these loops. Okay, so I got rid of this guy here because this one involved a blue string, and I'm going to get rid of all the blue strings. I'm only going to have red strings. It's just I'm going to allow branching of loops. So these are my rules that I want to obey. Put them up in the corner here. I'm going to put the model on a honeycomb lattice rather than on a square lattice. And the reason I'm going to put it on the honeycomb lattice is because it makes it easier to describe branching. So on my vertices, I'm going to allow an empty vertex, a vertex where a string comes in and then comes out, or a vertex where I have a branch where a string, you know, three strings come in and form a vertex. But I'm not going to allow an endpoint where a string comes in and stops. So, and it's easy enough to imagine writing down a Hamiltonian that has this property, that you just say that this is an energy penalty. So this is a possible ground state configuration. This is a possible configuration of this now branching string model. Similar to the Tor code, it's just I'm allowing them to branch now. So, good. So we have these vertex operators. Now, what do our plaquette operators look like? Well, our plaquette operators have to satisfy this surgery rule. So you get something that looks kind of like this. Again, I'm not going to completely justify this. But this plaquette operator, so maybe if a string comes into this plaquette like this and another string comes in to the plaquette like this, it will come out as a superposition. When I hit it with the plaquette operator, it's going to flip over the plaquette in all possible ways which still satisfy these vertex rules. So this satisfies the vertex rules, and these satisfy the vertex rules, and they get various configurations based on these coefficients. So I realize that I'm not justifying some of these, but you're gonna have to trust me a little bit that this all ends up working out. But there's consistency conditions which really pin down this model and its details. For example, if you have a straight string, the amplitude of that straight string in the wave function, the amplitude of that ket, which has a straight string in that wave function, should be the same as the amplitude of a ket that's deformed like this, a string that's deformed, because this is just the isotropy rule, that I can deform a string. But then I can use this surgery rule, that should be the same as the sum of the amplitudes of these two configurations by this surgery rules. But now this configuration here has a tadpole, and so the tadpole here, this loop with a one string coming off the end, should have zero amplitude. And this loop here can be removed at the price of delta, so the straight string has to have the same amplitude as A times delta times the straight string. So you get a consistency condition that A has to be 1 over delta. So there's all sorts of consistency conditions that you can derive on these kind of models, which pin down what kind of models you can write down. All right. So the wave functions that we write down are always some sort of superposition of all possible loop configurations. And in this case, the loop configurations are allowed to branch. And then the loop configurations have some weights as well. And the weights are cooked up such that if I remove a loop, the amplitude of the configuration changes by a factor of delta. And if I do surgery on some of these loops, the amplitude changes via this surgery rule. That it will be the amplitude of this will be the sum of the two amplitudes of these two configurations. Okay? Good? Yes? No? Yes? Good? Okay. Good. Okay. So now let's do the same thing we did with the Tor code. Let's go to a reference configuration. Our reference configuration is the situation with all the spins pointing up. In other words, no red loops at all. But really what we should imagine is we should imagine starting with all the red loops and then flipping over all the plaquettes in all possible ways via these flipping rules, which are slightly more complicated flipping rules, but it's still similar in spirit. Now, once I start with this reference configuration, I can create defects in my system exactly the same way I did before by making making strings with endpoints, and these are going to be defects. So now this is a picture where I have four defects in my model, and you can ask, well, can I actually see these strings between the defects? And just like in the Tor code, you can't actually see where the strings are between the defects because the strings are fluctuating all over the place. The real wave function is a superposition of all string configurations which satisfy these branching rules, but they all have vertex defects at these four points. So you know where the vertex, you know, when you go through with your error checks, you know that there are vertex defects at these four points, but these strings fluctuate all over the place, so you don't know how they were created. Okay? Now, you can ask, is this way of making four vertex defects, is that the same or is it different from this way of making four vertex defects? In other words, if I flip over enough plaquettes, can I turn from this thing into this thing or can I not? Are those independent wave functions or are they different wave functions? And I claim, in fact, that they are, in fact, different. And the way to argue that they're different is just by looking at these surgery rules, like this. Using this surgery rule, the amplitude for this has to be some sum of the amplitude for this plus the amplitude for this. And so immediately you know that these two things are going to be linearly independent kets in the system. And so that brings us back to this picture here. That now I have two configurations of in my system, which are mutually orthogonal, linearly independent in this case, kets in the system, where you can't measure anything locally to figure out that they're different, but globally they are different because they have different space-time histories. Okay. So that's more or less the moral of this story, that with a slight generalization of the toric code, you can get these topological phases of matter, which I was describing in the previous lecture, which has this property that when you add quasiparticles to it, you get linearly independent kets. And so when we back up to these definitions that we made of the properties of topological phases of matter, it will be true that the only dynamics in the bulk will come from this braiding, and that no local operator is going to be able to mix between the multiple ground states, and is exactly similar to the physics we found of the toric code, that really you're looking at some sort of parity quantum numbers, and you can't measure these parity quantum numbers locally. You have to measure them by measuring all the way around the handle of the torus. So for example, in this picture back here, the only way that you might know to figure out that these two particles were pulled apart from each other was to make a measurement of the parity of the number of strings cutting through a loop that runs all the way around these two particles, which would be different in this case. Well, I guess the parity in this case would be the same, but the parity in this case would be different if I make a loop around this and I measure the parity going all the way around that. Some very non-local measurement can distinguish the two kets from each other. Okay. I've actually ended a little bit too early, I'm afraid. I apologize by that. But if there's questions, I can take them, and I can fill up the last 10 minutes pretty easily. So thanks for listening.